In last session, we discussed about how to apply two different isolation levels, that is read uncommitted and read committed. Now let's start discussing about the remaining two and also the optimistic concurrency model supporting isolation levels, that is snapshot and read committed snapshot. First, let's start with repeatable or read. So repeatable read, it actually, the name says it eliminates the repeatable read concurrency issue. What is meant by repeatable read concurrency issue? When we discussed about concurrency issues, we also discussed about this. And this guy is transaction one and he has an update statement here, let's say, and this is the transaction two. He is selecting data here and he is selecting data here. Let's assume this is about the time factor, and first this is executing and this is executing from the transaction, a different transaction, and then this is. So this guy will set different, will get different set of data, and this select will get different set of data. Why? Because it is updating in the middle by another transaction. So when you have a repeatable read in one transaction, that is if you have more than one select statements on the same resource on one transaction, which is updating by another transaction, the same resource is being updated by another transaction, then you will get two different outputs for the two different select statements in the same transaction. So that doesn't give a proper meaning to the user who is using the data. For example, he reads the data here and he updates one column here. Let's assume he updates one column here and he reads the data again. And here in the second transaction, if you are updating some other column and this gets affected here in the second select statement, then people will get stunned thinking that I updated the XYZ column, but ABC column also got updated. So this repeatable read is one of the major issues we are facing, like it should be consistent. It leads to the consistency problem. Now, let's see how this repeatable read isolation level will solve that issue. So to explain the same, I need a table. Let's find out select star from dim product. Have good enough data. Now I'm starting a transaction here. Begin transaction. I'll name it as tran2 or tran1. I'm writing a select statement. Select star from dim product where product key is equal to 7. Okay. And before going to this, I'm setting the isolation level. Set transaction isolation level repeatable read. Now if you observe, I'm executing a transaction here and I'm opening the transaction and I'm not closing it. And if you observe clearly, I'm using the isolation level repeatable read. Oops. Okay, it read the data ML crankum and so on, and I'm taking one more query and I'm updating dim product. Update dim product set what is that, English product name is equal to Rupesh, where product key is equal to 7. If I execute this, it will be executing. It won't give you a chance to execute the particular update statement. Why? Because I'm having a repeatable read until I close this particular transaction. The other transactions can't update the data. That means what will happen? If I execute this again and again, I'll be getting the same data. If I have the select statement 100 times here in the same transaction, I'll be getting the same data. Now, once this transaction is completed, for example, commit TRAN 1. If I committed this transaction, then you can see it will give the wait for other transactions to do the updates or deletes, generally update the statements. Let's see. I'm committing the transaction here. Oops. Commit transaction. I don't need to specify. If I want to specify the name, I have to give like this. Commit transaction 1. Wait. Still it is running. You can see here. If I execute this, now you can see the one row affected. That means now the data is updated with the new name. Now if I execute this guy, it will be a new transaction again. And the name is Rupesh. And if I try to update with ML CRAN CRUM, I don't know the spelling. Let me go for this. CRAN CRUM, I think. If I execute this again, now it will be on hold. Why? Because I opened a transaction with the isolation level repeatable read. Until I finish this transaction, I cannot update or modify the data from outside, which means the complete transaction will read the same data. That data will be consistent throughout the transaction. So this is the advantage of having repeatable read. Now let me take another table. I'll go for a small one. I don't want to go for a big table. Let me take MSBI database, and in that I have pretty small tables. Let's say employee info 1. Select star from employee info. Let me take this guy, and it has 5 columns and 8 records. Now I'm applying the same stuff for this guy. Select star from employee info where employee ID. Employee ID is equal to 7. So it is fetching some record. It is getting some data. Now I'm executing the same isolation level on this particular table, this particular data. Let me go for a new one. Update employee underscore info set employee name is equal to Rupesh where employee info dot employee ID is equal to 7. Here I'm trying to update the same record just like I have done for DIM product. Why I have taken this example when I explain the DIM product? I'll come to that point shortly. Now this is still executing, and once I commit this particular transaction, then only you can see these guys getting updated. Now I'll do one thing. I'll go for this for complete transaction. Sorry, for complete table. So now the complete table is having a repeatable read isolation level set. Now until this particular transaction is committed, the complete rows will not be modified. Now what I'm gonna do here is insert into let's say employee underscore info values. I'm taking some values. Let's say 9 is the ID, name is Babu, and city, state, country. City is, let's say, BANG Bank. State is KA Karnataka, and country is INDIA. I already set a repeatable read on this particular table, repeatable read isolation level for the transaction which is pulling data from this table. If I execute this, you can see it is still executing, right? It is not inserting the data. Why? Because I have set the transaction isolation level to repeatable read to the complete table. Now let me insert this. It is inserted. What I'm gonna do here is where employee ID is equal to 7. I'm setting one more transaction level on this particular table, this particular row, and I'm taking the ID 10. If I click on insert, it is still processing and will be processing until the transaction is committed. You can see like this. So this is how you can avoid the data repeatable read, and it won't allow you to get the fetch the fresh data, and it won't give you any surprise outputs for the second select in the same transaction. So this is the super good advantage that we have for repeatable read isolation level. Now the next set of isolation level is, I mean, it is pretty simple, similar one, like instead of, see, it is serializable, everything it's like serializable. I mean, it won't give chance to insert, update or modify the data when one transaction is having the logs. Lizable, okay, I think I'm correct the spelling. And let me execute this transaction. It is having the same stuff, and now I'm trying to insert the data into the same table. And it looks, I mean, this one and the last one looks pretty simple, similar one, and here it won't allow to delete or insert or update any stuff into the particular table if you set it to serializable. That there is a very little difference between the serializable one and the repeatable read. That little difference is serializable will go for locking at the index level. If it has any index defined in the table, then it will go on lock, apply the locks at the index level, which will not allow, which will not give any chance to insert or update or delete the data from the table that is being locked using the serializable. You can see the same. And if you try to delete the data also, now let me set the isolation level again, and when I try to delete the data, delete from employee underscore info where employee ID is equal to 7, you have to wait until the transaction is closed. It won't give you chances to delete the data. And see, this the problem here is, if you observe the transaction, the two transactions properly, this guy has to be online or in waiting mode until the first transaction is committed. This is the place where we where we face a lot of problems. So let's say you have two different transactions. One is inserting 1 crore records, which will take 1 hour of time. Another one is deleting 1 record from the database table, which will take 1 second. But this guy, the one which is inserting the record, sets the log first, then the second guy has to wait until the first one is finished. Okay, when these two transactions are two complex transactions, then we're gone. Both will go for a hang state, and there we have to close or stop any one of the transaction manually so that the second one will continue processing. And once the second one is completed, then you can restart the first transaction. So this is how the problem, when the isolation level advantages are increasing, concurrency problem solving capability is increasing, you can see the data concurrency or data availability is reducing hugely. You can see not even a single record can be modified or updated or deleted, or in short cannot be accessed by the second transaction until the first one is committed. So this is about all the four different transaction level, different transaction isolation levels that supports for that is under pessimistic concurrency model. There is nothing much difference between pessimistic and optimistic concurrency model isolation levels. Pessimistic means it applies logs. That's it. It takes the help of logs. And optimistic means it won't take the help of logs. It will directly think that I don't need any log and there won't be any deadlock chances, and I can, it handles in a different way rather than having logs, which we are going to discuss in a couple of minutes. So before going to the optimistic concurrency model, let's rewind whatever we discussed till now, and then we'll jump into the optimistic concurrency model isolation levels. So the top one, the father of everything, is transaction. This guy has ACID properties, A, C, I, D. And this I is the story. What we discussed in last three sessions is the about transactions, and last two sessions, current one and the last one, is mainly about isolation. This guy makes the two transactions isolated up to the level that we are looking for. Okay, this is for isolation level. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 isolation levels. Read uncommitted, read committed, repeatable read, and serializable and snapshot. So repeatable read and serializable falls under pessimistic concurrency model, and this guy snapshot falls under optimistic, and this guy falls under both. It can be used using both, either optimistic that is using logs and pessimistic that is without using logs. So, and in short, pessimistic means which uses the logs, and optimistic means which don't take the help of log, and it will go for a different concept called row versioning to provide uniqueness or to provide unique data. And let's discuss about that one now. Let me take that out. Okay, optimistic isolation levels. Under this we have two, one is snapshot, another one is the committed snapshot. So snapshot and read committed snapshot, before going to these two things, let's talk about row versioning. Generally, this row versioning, let's say this, I inserted one record. Okay, I have a table and I have 10 records, let's say, like this. If I updated this particular record, then what will happen is the old value will be maintained in tempdb database. It will be maintained in tempdb database. A new value will be updated to this guy. Okay, let's assume a transaction is executing, transaction 1 with snapshot transaction type, isolation level type, and the transaction 2 is updating. This is reading data using multiple select statements. Okay, this is updating data. So when it starts reading the data, it will go get the value from here, the last value, or from here, from this guy. And once it started getting the data, if this is updating this record, if this guy is updated this record, then it won't worry and it won't apply any logs. It won't allow, it will allow the second transaction to update the record, but for the consecutive select statements, it will go and find the same record. There will be a link between the updated record and the last value for the same record. So it will, based on the link, it will go and get the data from the tempdb. The tempdb will have the row versioning. Generally, what is the use of row versioning? To maintain different copies of the same software, or different changes that has been made and the different intervals of time can be tracked using row versioning. If I make some changes today, I'll maintain one row version number. If I maintain some changes tomorrow, I'll maintain one version number. So if I want to go back to the changes that I have done on so-and-so date, I can go back to the particular date. In the same way, this row versioning here, all the select statements in the first transaction will be reading the same data that is stored in the, that will be stored in the tempdb whenever you make the changes to the original table. So this is how this optimistic isolation levels make sure that it is reading the same data throughout the complete transaction, and hence you don't need, making the use of locking mechanism. This snapshot is almost equal to serializable isolation level, which falls under pessimistic concurrency model isolation levels. But the only difference is this guy does not use locking mechanism, and this guy uses row versioning mechanism. It is not straightforward one to set the row versioning. There are a couple of problems if you go for row versioning. Imagine if I am updating the same record again and again and again, there will be, the tempdb size will grow like anything. Why? Because there will be lot of different version data will be stored in that MDB for accessing in transactions. So the MDB size will grow like anything, and that is the major disadvantage if you go for this row versioning part. I mean the snapshot isolation level and recommitted snapshot isolation level. So what generally people will do is they will move this MDB. They will move the MDB files to storage to different folder where the size is where the space is pretty huge. If they opt for snapshot isolation level, generally people go for serializable or repeatable read isolation levels, and they don't come to the snapshot and recommitted snapshot isolation levels. Now let's see the first step in it. That is, you have to enable the row versioning part, right? How can you do that? It can be done at database level. Let's see, alter database, and the name of the database is MSBA, and now I'm going for set command, set allow snapshot isolation true, or I think it's in second. Okay, so alter database name, set allow snapshot isolation level to true. Let me execute this. It's saying incorrect syntax, I think. I mean, I've never shared this. Let me find out which one. Yeah, it should be on. Should be off by default. Let's try with on. So if I execute this now, this is successfully completed. From now onwards, this database has the capability, and it will maintain the row versioning part. And now let's see how to make use of the snapshot isolation level. In the same way, set transaction isolation level as snapshot. Okay, begin transaction, and what I'm doing here is I'm selecting the data from the same table. Select start from the table is employee info. Okay, where employee ID is equal to 7. Let me execute this. It is saying invalid. Don't we have this table? What is the table name? Is it employee underscore info? Yeah, true. Okay, let me execute this. Oops, there is no data with this employee ID. Let me try with employee. Okay, now I selected the record where employee ID is equal to 8 and the name of the guy is Sukumar and city is Hyderabad, AP and India. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to the another window where I'm trying to update the data. Okay, update employee underscore info, set name is equal to Sukumar without space. There was space, I think. No, there was no space. I'll give space. Sukumar where employee ID is equal to 8. Now what will happen if I execute this? If I execute this particular record, generally if you apply repeatable read or snapshot isolation levels, sorry, serializable isolation levels, obviously it will be waiting in line, right? It will be waiting in line to execute this particular guy, I mean to update the record of this particular guy. But here if you observe, it says one row affected. The record is updated as per the output what it is showing. Let's see the same. Select start from employee underscore info, and if you see, it is fine. And let me come back here and let me execute it. You can see it is still showing the old value, but this transaction, but here it is executing and it is updating the new value and it is returning the new value, but the same old transaction will be getting the data from the temp DB where the reference will be set to the record what we are referring. This particular record will have a reference in the temp DB and it will be fetching the data from the temp DB, and you can see it will be repeating, it will be repeatedly getting the same data until you commit this transaction. So this guy is awesome, right? I mean, if you see, I committed the transaction. Now if I execute the same thing, still it is getting the same data until you close this section, and until you go for a new transaction, you'll get the, you'll be getting the same data. And now if you go for the third and fourth transaction also, let me go for the second, third, a couple of other transactions. Set transaction, I'll copy the same code. Isolation level 2 snapshot, begin tran 1, select start from employee_info. So if you see, until the snapshot, if you take the snapshot, what it is doing, it is getting the data from the temp DB, it is not going for the same old one, and this is part of your snapshot, right? And here if you take the same query from the outside of this, it is getting the new value. And now what I'm gonna do here is set transaction isolation level snapshot. I'm using snapshot isolation level for this and getting the data. Now this is all together a new connection. Let me close this connection here. Until this connection persists, it will go and get the data from the same old before closing the windows. Yes, I'll commit the transactions. I don't want to save it. Let me go for a new one. Let me take a new transaction here. And if I execute this, you can see the new value is coming. So if you set a connection using a window, or using, if you open a connection and if you execute, you'll be getting the same old data even though you modified the data in other transaction. So this is, I mean, whenever you want to get the fresh data, I mean, whenever you want to have the power to update the data in the table while the other transaction is reading it without applying any logs. If you apply logs, what's the problem? Obviously, the second transaction can't update the records, can't modify the records, can't delete the records, can't insert the records. But here it is using the row versioning part, and this is a super good advantage. But the problem is the temp DB size will grow like anything. It will grow like too fast in data warehousing, databases, like where you will be inserting some millions and millions of records on daily basis, or sometimes you need to update so many records on daily basis. So in that case, the temp DB size will grow like anything. All the transactions, all the records will have references. So that leads to a lot of problem in the performance wise. I mean, the size of the temp DB grows, and if the temp DB is not available for other transactions, then the performance issue will come into picture. Now to explain the same using the other one, that is repeatable read commit, right? Read commit snapshot. We have to make one more change for this, okay? It just like I made a couple of changes, right? By executing the alter database database name, I have to set one more thing on, that is recommitted snapshot. So along with allow isolation snapshot, right, the one which I executed now, I mean, before discussing about the snapshot, I altered the database, right? Allow snapshot isolation. In the same way, you have to alter the database and set this one to on if you want to make use of the, oh, some transaction is going on. Let me commit the transactions. And then let's go for this guy. If there is any open transactions, nothing. Now let me execute this guy. Alter database, database name, set read commit underscore read underscore commit underscore snapshot to on. Once it is set to on, it is exactly functions like read commit under pessimistic concurrency model. It has the same functionality. The only difference is it won't take the help of locking mechanism. Now, if you take the pen here, let's say this is your read commit. What read commit will do? It won't allow you to read the data until it is committed, right? Here, when it tries to read, if some other transaction is updating this particular data, then until this guy is committed, it won't allow you to read the data. Or whenever it is reading the data, it won't allow the other transaction to commit or to modify the data. But here the case is different. It will allow the other transactions to commit, I mean to update the changes, and at the same time it will read the same data but from the MDB. It will make use of the MDB and the row versioning concepts. And this row versioning concept, if you have on record here, and when I update this record, immediately similar structure will be created in this database, MDB database, and this record will be stored there. The updated record, I mean the old value will be stored here, the complete row will be stored, and a reference will be, let's say there will be a unique ID which will be set between these two records, so that it can be referred easily. There should be some reference, right, saying that this particular, the first record is for this particular first record is for this particular first record. So the reference will be set like that. There will be different levels of references. It depends on how many transaction requests you are getting in parallel. So the both uses the row versioning concept and TempDB database, and both does not use locking mechanism, which will help us in avoiding, in allowing the other transactions to modify the data when reading the data by another transaction. And it won't give us repeatable reads, and it won't give us dirty reads, it won't give us lost updates problem, and it won't give us the phantom reads. So all the concurrency problems will be solved without using the locking mechanism, that is using optimistic concurrency model. So this is about different the remaining concurrency isolation level, sorry, not transaction isolation levels, and it's always good to have a good complete picture about these isolation levels, and you can expect a lot of questions from this. If you answer one question in interview in a better way, then the interviewer obviously will expect that later answer to the next question in the same concepts, isolation levels, in a better way. So if you have a complete knowledge in this one, then they will come to a conclusion that you are really experienced. Why? Because fake guys never go for these isolation levels or transactions. These transactions, at least 3 to 4 questions you can expect, and practice it with examples, with lot hell of examples. Try out, don't leave, read articles, go through the video again and find out what is the difference, what are the different concurrency issues and everything. If you have complete grip on these transactions, then it will be always a good and interesting our topic also to learn and understand. That's it for today's session, and in next session we are going to discuss, or we are going to focus one complete session, that is one complete video on triggers, the different types of triggers and how to define trigger and how it works. Is it possible to call the trigger manually? All these things we will discuss in the next session. Thank you guys.